Today I have friend of the show, Richard Otten, on the line with me. We had a little chat when the whole COVID-19 virus hit, and it turned out that over in the Netherlands, he was working with a company that was producing a white paper, which was all about thinking different in times of crisis. So I got him on the show to talk to me about the white paper and what it recommends to business owners in this industry. Welcome to episode 28. Glamping and unique holiday rentals are surging in popularity with the growing desire of customers to book holidays that deliver an experience. They are also the new business of choice for those wanting to improve their work-life balance. So how do you build a strong business like this that gives you the life you need and a great investment? I'm Sarah Riley, and I want to share what I've discovered after being immersed in this industry for over 20 years to inspire you to find out more about what's going on. Welcome. This is the Business of Glamping and Unique Holiday Rentals. So I'm very happy to have on the podcast today my colleague from the Netherlands. Richard Otten has been working in this industry for many years now. He has a couple of businesses and responsibilities, and they include glamping.nl, and also he provides media services to campsites and glamp sites across Europe. So I was very pleased when we spoke, he got in touch, and he had been working with Lux & Tenton to come up with a white paper, a paper of guidance to help people at this time who have sites or who want to have sites to think through what they need to do to prepare for the reopening of this industry when this virus has got under control. So Richard very kindly came onto the episode today to talk through his perspective, what he's seeing in the industry as far as where he's located, and what he's hearing from businesses over in Europe, and of course the guidance in the white paper and where you can get a copy for yourself. Richard, you've been involved in this white paper, which is titled Thinking Differently in Times of Crisis. And I've only just had a look at the white paper because it literally is hot off the press yesterday or the day before, something like that. Mm-hmm. And the paper is talking about tips for campsites and holiday parks in how they can deal with this crisis and how they can take action for the new economy that is coming out now. It's actually from when we talked earlier, in when this crisis first hit, and you talked about a 1 meter or 1.5 meter economy, and I've been talking about that ever since. And in the UK it's 2 meters, people have to, you know, isolate from each other and have distancing of 2 meters, and so we're calling it the 2 meter economy. So firstly, tell me, how did this white paper come about and what's your involvement been in it?
Well, as the owner of Blogs for Travel, which is a content marketing bureau in Holland, we are very involved with our client Lux & Tenton, which of course is a manufacturer of safari tents worldwide. And I think they were... there has been a takeover within the company, I think it was 1.5 years ago, and they really want to expand. And of course, they did a very good job. They were visible everywhere and every fair in all the world. And at the same time, I think for their organization, they already, well, made the contracts, etc., for the preparation of the season. And then, of course, this happened in March, which is the most terrible month, I think, for all the season and holiday, the whole holiday industry. So I think Lux & Tenton took up their share and said, well, we want to give some information because everybody is in search for good information about all these measures being taken by the governments within Europe and also worldwide, but mostly within Europe, which is very differently, of course. We do not see any European guidelines for the moment. And every country is on his own. So, this white paper wants to help glamping owners and campsite owners in their quest to have good information to prepare and also give some insights that we found in a couple of sources. So yeah, it's public. It's written for this industry that we are involved in to help each other, because I think you will agree with me on that. We have to share information. We have to share knowledge specifically in this time of crisis.
Absolutely. And so what country are you based in? For the listeners, tell a little bit about where you're based.
We are based in Holland. Like I said, as a marketing bureau, but we also have one website we own, which is glamping.nl, which is the biggest website for people to look up on their glamping holiday, let's say. And we work a lot with tour operators and individual campsite owners within Europe to get question and demand on our website. But at the same time, we also help companies like Luxetenten in their social media strategy and their content strategy. So that is my role in this part.
So what are you witnessing where you are? Are you still in lockdown? Are there still significant changes to your lifestyle?
Yes and no. Of course, Holland did had a lockdown, but they called it an intelligent lockdown. So they said, well, we're not going to give everybody a paper with evidence if you want to be on the street, like in Spain, Italy, and France. It is more like we see in Germany, Denmark, and maybe Sweden as well. It's like more that kind of lockdown. So everybody has to be at home. But there were exceptions, and a lot of stores were still open, but of course not the bars, and specifically campsites were still open. I think that is also important to know, that in a lot of countries, of course, campsites were closed, were really closed by governments. In our country, it was not the case. Only a couple of regions where the hospitals were not able to take care of, let's say, a bigger crowd. So they said, well, that region has to be in a total lockdown. But of course, we are now 7 weeks further already in this crisis. So now we are opening up again, as everyone else, I think, a little bit in Europe. And as of Monday, 11 May, there will be schools again open. There will be a little bit more openness in the country. And then the 1st of June, there will be more open. And what is now announced is that the 1st of July, campsites can be totally open, also with their toilet buildings, etc. So we are looking towards a summer that is possible. But that is, of course, if the virus is still contained in a way that we are doing now. So that is with big insecurity.
So that's actually very different to our situation in the UK.
Yeah, how
everything
is that?
Everything is shut. Everything is shut. And we have no notice at the moment of when we will be coming out of a phased lockdown. And we are being given hints that in terms of campsites and glamping, and unique holiday rentals and holiday accommodation, we won't be able to open any of it until June, July. So, but we have no guidance yet. So everyone's still very much in the lockdown frame of mind. And there is right now, you know, great deal of concern in those areas, in such as the southwest in the UK, which is Cornwall and Devon, where the majority of their business is tourism. So yes, this is a very big impact in terms of the economy. So what, in terms of what is happening for you and in Europe, is there anything positive to think through?
Well, I think the word positive, we have to downgrade it. Let's say nothing at the moment, I think, for tourism and for the industry is positive. But if you look into the fact that we are in this crisis already for a couple of weeks and there are things opening up a little bit, that gives a glance to hold on to. I think we have to put it like this. So in that case, what is positive, like I said, in Holland, we see that campsites can be open. I have a positive feeling that hopefully the European Union will give in mid-May some guidelines towards the all the countries, that within the Schengen countries there will be open boundaries. But of course, it will be very insecure how many people will take the risk to travel to another country. Because of course, if the the borders will be closed, well, that pretty much ends a lot of things, and especially campsites and glamping owners that are very into accepting people from another country, of course, like in France. You will have in France a lot of campsite and glamping owners with a majority of English, Dutch, Belgian, German customers. So if that stays away, then of course the whole business has to turn towards domestic holiday, which can be possible, because I think in every country that will be the case. And that maybe also a lot of people that normally go on a cruise, or they take a big trip towards the America or another country outside of Europe, they will stay within the country and then maybe discover the campsite. So in the end, it could be a benefit for the glamping and camping industry, but you really have to look through all the mess towards the prospect and hopefully future that will be there. But of course, I think that will be the big question now. Everybody's waiting for European guidelines, and of course within the next 2-3 weeks, what will happen with the virus? Do we have another vague coming up? Or is there a possibility that we can maintain these numbers of people getting ill and getting in hospital and the economy can open up a little bit? Because then I think the summer will be possible, but of course in a shape that will be very less than what it would be. Because it would be a very good year, like we just discussed before the podcast. Yeah, 2020 was an exceptional year, I think, for a lot of people. And now, of course, everybody thinks at a certain moment there will be a crisis, because that is normal. But I think nobody could anticipate on this crisis that is this deep and this destructive, I think.
Yeah, absolutely. And we had some terrible news from the Bank of England yesterday, warning that we are due to have the deepest recession on record since 1706. So this is based on the lockdown ending in June, between June and September.
Yeah.
But on the positive side, it expects that it could rebound to 15% early in 2021, and then hopefully get back to normal pretty much by the end of 2021. So things aren't terribly, terribly bleak, but in the short term, this is going to be very impactful on a lot of companies. And so this is why I grabbed onto the opportunity to hear about your white paper when I heard that it was being put together.
Yeah, what do you think, because of course it's a big document in total, what were maybe the highlights that you pointed out? Because of course maybe some information for you was already, well, you knew it or you heard about it, but were there some articles that were different or new for you?
Well, the thing that I really liked about the overall feel of it is that it was giving advice, but it wasn't being too prescriptive. So it wasn't saying you must do this, you must do that. It was giving really good, sound suggestions on what people could do to take a look at how they open their sites in the coming months when they're allowed to, when they come out of lockdown. And one of the things also that I found very beneficial was where it talks about looking at the cost-benefit analysis for individual sites.
Right.
Because not every site will think that it's worth them opening. Maybe they have gone into some kind of business kind of sleep. They've turned everything off. Their staff are in furlough, or they have chosen not to employ their seasonal staff, and they may decide that this year they just aren't going to focus on opening and they're going to pause until next year. So that's what I liked about the document, that it talks about you have to make the right decision for you and your business and where you are in the world.
For the moment, I talk with a lot of owners, of course, and I think it's very depending on the region, your customers, how many accommodations you have with your own bathroom in it or not. So yeah, that are all questions you have to think about. And of course, if you have a lot of costs opening up and it's only for a couple of weeks, you have to question yourself if it's really worth the effort, or that you will postpone everything that you have towards next year. Because like I said before, it could be a benefit for the glamping and camping industry in the end, if we sort this crisis altogether. Then I think there will be a lot of people with a big desire towards nature, towards sustainability, and I think glamping is spot on that. So we have to be hopeful. We have to, well, stay together in this crisis and then sort it together, and then we will have a good business. But of course, yeah, maybe for some businesses that will be too late, depending on how long this will take, of course.
Absolutely. And it's about putting things in place to be able to ride out the storm of the recession. And that's why I've been providing a lot of free training in my Facebook group for people to understand how they can take action now while they are in a pause state to prepare for either opening up or at the very least to think about what they're going to do for their own business model and location. But it was very enlightening and also encouraging when I was very fortunate to be able to attend a lecture from a worldwide economist called Ian Golding. And this man has got credentials as long as my arm. And he, in his last book, he predicted that the next recession, the next worldwide economic crisis, would be linked to a pandemic. And so, of course, everyone's very eager to hear his opinion on what might happen next. So I was in this lecture, and without any prompting from me or questions from me, he announced that he felt that any business that was able to provide an experience where people could come together in nature and do those things that they've missed the most, such as being together with friends and family in a social environment in nature where they can wind down and de-stress and all of those things, go hiking, all of the things that we've missed after being in lockdown will survive, right, if yep, they can navigate this immediate short-term crisis. So in a way, that was really encouraging. What do you think about that?
I agree totally. And what would also be beneficial, because I remembered we talked about that in an earlier podcast, is that small glamping owners based on a small structure and not like the big mass campsites, they are more adapting and maybe faster adapting towards the opening up of the economy, and then in the end will provide a better service, like you say, towards the demand of the changing tourist, of course. Because I think in the end the corona crisis is very bad, but in a way also a wake-up call to change drastically our way in travel. Because yeah, we already talked about that, and it could be like a game changer, like a tipping point in that demand for a lot of people. Not going in the plane anymore to Spain, but maybe stay in your own country and go to the south of England and then stay in a safari tent. Why not?
Yeah, especially as there are predictions that those prices of tickets are going
will rise,
to increase. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And it's only to be expected. There's lots of talk of companies going out of business. There's going to be less flights, less, you know, tickets available. And obviously, if you've got that amount of supply reducing, then they're going to put the prices up. And
right,
yeah, it's going to change things. But as you say, I wonder if this could actually push us all in the direction of making some better choices that will help the environment, that will help the impact of our, you know, activities and behavior on the environment. And we've collectively seen that during this lockdown and shift in our behavior,
yeah.
And the pollution levels going down that have been measured from space. And before this, I was thinking, you know, what can I do? And how will my changing my activities and being more eco-friendly, how could that possibly have a positive impact on the environment?
Right. And now we see it.
Now we see it. Absolutely. So now I feel much more motivated to do bigger things and change bigger things.
I agree. But at the same time, of course, we have to be realistic that when it will be possible to go on a cheap ticket towards Spain or Turkey, people will do that. Of course, I think it's optimistic to think that a crisis will change behavior in the long run. But then at the same time, there are some aspects of this crisis, like a domestic holiday, which is now being, you cannot do differently. So you will have to do it. And then you will discover that like here in Holland, for example, we have beautiful nature, etc. So I think it will be in this way that we will see that, like I said, glamping and campsites will profit in the end. But of course, they will have to navigate through this crisis. And I think one of the things which is also stating in the white paper that online visibility is one of the topics we talk about in the white paper is very important. Even now, and maybe better, especially now, you have to invest in your website, you have to invest in your social media strategy to be visible for these customers, especially because you will touch a lot of customers which were never customers before. So you have to think outside of the box and try to adapt your organization. And like I said, if you have a smaller organization, then you will be more adaptive towards which is now the new reality.
Absolutely. I couldn't agree more. I mean, this is the way things are going, isn't it? That we are moving. And partly this whole crisis has been a catalyst for making this happen faster for some people. We are moving offline to online. People are now using it more to search for all kinds of things and changing their behavior, how they search for their holidays and their future stays in unique spaces. So we all have to be there to make sure that people see our business and that we are visible. And without that, I fear some businesses just won't survive, or at least their costs will go up significantly as they just rely heavily on the online travel agents.
Right.
But they haven't particularly behaved very well, the online travel agents, during this crisis. Some of them have been amazing, but others have been very bad.
Yep.
And so I think that in itself is going to shift a lot of people's thinking in how they feel they need to go forward to get their bookings.
Yeah.
And hopefully that will be of benefit to them because they'll have less expenses, less commission to pay on each booking.
True.
But they do need to learn new skills to be able to get their business online and to get it visible.
Yeah, that's very important. And of course, I can understand that as a glamp site owner and you are affected now but a lot of people wanting to change the date of their holiday, asking questions, etc. So you're very heavily involved with running the business and surviving. But at the same time, don't forget to communicate. Don't forget the marketing, because it's always one of the first things that will be cut off. And of course, I can understand that you will not put any money at the moment in Facebook or Google AdWords. But social media, let's say your own content that you put out there is for free. The only thing is that you have to invest this time. And we see a significantly difference between campsites and glampings that are already heavily visible on Facebook and Instagram, for example, that have invested in that for many years already. They are now in advance of other campsites that haven't done that. Because of course, for the moment, the only connection that you have with your customer is by phone or email, but then it's all negative. Like I said, it's about changing the dates, etc. So on social media, you can put out another message, like an online animation program, or I don't know, show some images of your company. So that is very important. And at the same time, what we see now in Holland is, of course, that based on the press conference last Tuesday, they said, well, domestic holiday could be possible, like I mentioned before, from the 1st of July. So that will lead up to a run on new bookings for the season. So at a certain point, you have to also invest again in visibility with AdWords and Facebook, etc. Yeah. So yeah, be very be careful with that, but at the same time, don't cut it off total. I think that's a wrong decision.
Yes, and that paid advertising, because you can switch it on and off like a tap, it's
right.
Really important to be prepared to do that at the beginning, so you can start getting the bookings coming in when you're ready to launch and open the doors again to your customers and at the moment, we all have time to think through our ads, our visual assets that we'll put to it, the type of wording that we might use. And one of the things that I'm telling to people who are in my Facebook group is, think about sketching that out now. Think about getting that with, you know, your Google Ads account, your Facebook Ads account, getting it endorsed, authorized by the platform, so that you're ready to hit the button, you're ready to go as soon as you're able to. You don't have to run it now. You can have it on pause and you can have a very low budget, but it's about making sure it's there and ready. And these are all things we can do to prepare.
Exactly the same with writing a blog. You can already prepare your content because you will know that at a certain moment, like you're saying now in England, you are not ready for like opening up from the lockdown, but it will be there eventually. So you can already prepare for that. Yeah, sure.
So how is the animation that you provide? How is that used by sites?
Well, what we see now is that in Holland during the holiday of the, well, May holiday it's called, it's the last 2 weeks, there were a couple of campsites, like I said, well, every campsite was open, but also open with some customers. To put it in perspective, maybe 10 or 15%, of course, like on a normal level, but with some children. And then we did like animation on distance. So it was not a mini club that you would go into and that there will be creativity, but it will be more like the animation team is distributing all the things to do for the children at the mobile homes, at the safari tent. So that is something that we did already. And the first sites were very positive. The people liked it. They were very enthusiastic that, oh my God, there was something happening and we are coming to the campsite and you even have animation. So it was higher expectation than what they thought. So that's always positive. And of course, at the same time, we made like this COVID Corona protocol to make sure that what we do is correct concerning all the hygiene measures that you have to take. And I think that's the same thing you have to do when you have like guests on your campsite. Make sure that your protocol or all your measures that you have to do, that you are prepared for that as well, because I think that will be very important, not only for the check that will be done by the government to see if you are in order by what the measures are in every country, because of course in every country it's a little bit different, but also to make the guest feel secure. I think that's the only way to attract guests in the end, because they need to come and they need to feel secure where they are. So animation is possible, but like I said, on distance and differently and online. And in that perspective, you can also say like an online check-in is already possible. You can really do a lot of things already, but you have to think differently than what you did before. So in all that elements that you like check-in, hygiene, animation, you all have to rethink it.
Mm, absolutely. And I think that having that in mind, what we've talked about earlier about that 1.5 meter economy or the 2 meter economy is a really great way of putting it and summarizing it, that think about everything that you have to do that allows people to keep that distance between each other on site and around the facilities, and to help keep them safe, but more than anything, to help them keep that sense that they are not fearful of what they could get, you know, if they came into contact with the virus. But that's one of the things that we have struggled with the most, and I think a lot of us will struggle with in the future, which is that fear.
Right.
And I think that potentially could stop people from having a holiday because they're fearful.
And at the same time, maybe also owners that are fearful as well. I've talked to owners that said, well, I don't want to open up because I don't want to have that responsibility if something will happen. But at the same time, we have to try to be realistic and stay positive at the same time, and see day by day or maybe week by week how things are going. So it's not wise at the moment to look any further than 1 month, because you don't know. So you can make yourself very depressed maybe by looking 3-4 months ahead. But you just don't know. But as an entrepreneur, you have to anticipate and try to see, okay, these are the different scenarios that could be possible. And I think, like I said before, every campsite or every glamping owner has a different approach in that. Can I open up or not? Do I have people from another country or not, etc.? But yeah, you also have the responsibility to look out for your own business. So yeah, that's why we wrote this white paper, to give that advice and be a partner. I think Luxe Tenten also wants to point that out. It's not only to provide the safari tent as a manufacturer. It's also about sharing this as an industry. I think one thing is written down in the white paper as well, and I couldn't agree more. Relationship is gold. At the moment, what I see now is that everybody that has a good relationship with one another, they accept that, yeah, we are all feeling the pain and we have to come out together. So relationship is very important.
Absolutely. And yet we are all experiencing this in our own individual ways as well. So we have to be very thoughtful about each other and considerate of each other. And I know that certainly in my Facebook group, people are being that. But I think that challenge will come when we were talking earlier about, you know, there are three things here. There is the owner of the site, there is the guest who likes to visit the site, and then there is the community in which the site is located.
Right.
And those are three key areas that need to be considered, because there is fear in the community as well that when the tourists come back, will they bring the virus?
Exactly.
So, there is a lot of elements we need to all consider, and this isn't going to be easy, but there is a lot of support out there, and I think it's fantastic that you've done this white paper. And how can they get hold of a copy? Would it be okay for me to include a copy with the show notes for this episode?
Sure. I think the more people read it and can share it, the better. So I would propose that where we can provide and share this information, we have to do it. So in the show notes, of course, but you can also share it in the group that you have on Facebook.
Yes.
Of course, some may apply on a specific country, but I think in general, all the advices are given for every glampsite owner and for every campsite owner out there to make like a roadmap, let's say it like this.
Yeah.
To attack this crisis which is ahead of us.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think it's fantastic that everyone is pulling together to try and get through this. So thank you so much for coming on the podcast this morning. I really appreciate you giving your time. And I know that anyone who downloads the white paper will be incredibly grateful. So I thank you on behalf of them.
Yeah.
And, you know, good luck, Richard.
If there is anything that they want to ask, of course, they can contact me. I think best way is maybe on Facebook or LinkedIn. Full name Richard Otten, of course. And if there's any question which isn't answered, well, like you said, it's not 100% full of information. Maybe something is left out. But yeah, please, if there's any feedback, please let me know.
Fabulous. Thank you so much. Take care.
Thanks for having me, Sarah.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
So to download your copy of the white paper, just go to the show notes for this episode, which is inspiredcamping.com/028, as this is episode 28. It'd be really good to have your feedback. I know Richard and also Luxe Tenten would be really happy to have your feedback about the white paper and anything else that you've experienced during this lockdown, and also about your thoughts for the future. If you want to get in touch, then you can do that through Inspired Camping, but you can also go to my site over on inspiredcourses.com. There's all kinds of tools and resources over there that I've made available to anyone who is struggling at this time, who wants to prepare for the release of lockdown and getting the tourism industry back on track. So you can find that over on inspiredcourses.com/tools. Finally, if you want to be part of the Facebook community, who are really pulling together at the moment to give each other as much support as possible, just go on over to inspiredcourses.com/Facebook, and that is where you request your membership and come on in, because we're all there and we're ready to help. You shouldn't be doing this on your own. Take care and see you in the next episode.